Coming to yourself before you come to Jesus. Coming to yourself before you come to Jesus. Look at Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. Coming to yourself before you come to Jesus. Pastor Kightley was ministering last week, and I just was taking notes, and I felt so much that the Holy Spirit dropped into my spirit and my heart that title or that scripture and that reminding of that scripture in Luke chapter 15. I'm going to read a little bit of it to you and get us in the right setting for this, okay? How many of you are here? All right, now Luke chapter 15 and verse 11. And he said, there was a certain man who had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the part of the property that falls to me. And he divided the estate between them. Now we all know this scripture, but sometimes we can see it under a different light. And not many days after that, the younger son gathered up all that he had and journeyed into a distant country. And there he wasted his fortune in reckless and loose from restraint living. And when he had spent all he had, mighty famine came upon that country, and he began to fall behind, and he began to be in want. He got in debt, lost all his money, and he began to become in want. And so he went and glued himself upon one of the citizens of that country. Now that's really important to see this, because I'm going to come back to it. He went and he glued himself upon one of the citizens of that country. He attached himself to somebody who sent him into the fields to feed hogs. Now, how many of you know we're talking Jewish here? What's the boy doing around hogs? Something out of whack here. You know, something ain't right. How many of you get this? Because Jewish people don't eat pork. So here's the problem. He's in a pig farm, and they're not supposed to be dealing with pigs. Something's really got him out of whack. Can you hear that? Verse 16, and he would gladly have fed on and filled his belly with the carob pods that the hogs were eating. But they could not satisfy his hunger, and nobody gave him anything better. And then when he came to himself, there it is, verse 17. When he came to himself, wow, that's important. He said, how many hired servants of my father have enough food and even food to spare, but I'm perishing, dying here of hunger? He began to look around and he began to think about those of his father's house and how many blessings were on them and why he wasn't receiving those blessings. Let me hear that. And then it says, and then he came to himself, how many hired servants of my father have enough food, even food to spare, but I'm perishing. And then it says, and I will get up and I will go to my father and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. Notice now, he brings it into deep reality that God the Father, he's got to get it right before God the Father, and he's got to get it right in the sight of his own natural father. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me like one of your hired servants. In other words, he said, I've realized that I broke covenant and I'm away, and I'll be satisfied if I can just be a servant in the house of God. Okay. And just make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and came to his own father. But while in verse 18 and verse 20 are two similar verses there, and it's important to see that. So he got up and he came to his own father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was moved with pity and tenderness for him. And he ran and embraced him and kissed him fervently. Now, how many of you know this was a very wealthy man? This old fellow, the dad, he was an estate owner. He had many, many slaves and people that worked for him. He was very, very wealthy. And in the culture of that time, showing any outward display like that of running after someone would have not happened. He probably alarmed those that were his bodyguards and those that were assigned to watch over him. They probably were just absolutely shook at the fact he took off running. And it says he ran, embraced him, and kissed him fervently. Now, that doesn't mean he just, you know, gave him a little peck on the top of his head. I mean, he got down and just hugged and wrestled and rolled and was so overwhelmed. Verse 21, and the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. I no longer deserve to be recognized as a son of yours. But the father said to his bondservant, bring quickly. Bondservant is a love servant. He said, bring quickly the best robe. So those attendants that he had around him, he said to one of them, go get me the best robe, the favorite robe of honor, and put it on him and give him a ring for his hand and sandals for his feet. And bring out the wheat and the fatted calf and kill it. And let us revel and feast and be happy and make merry. Because this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found, and they began to revel and feast and make merry. I'm going to stop there. And there's another part to this, but I'm just going to stop. Notice this is a scripture. It's a parable. There's three of these. There's a lost sheep, a lost coin, and a lost son. Have you hear that? Lost sheep, lost coin, and a lost son. There's so much in here that really I could have spent days, but you're not hungry, I don't think, today, so I'm only going to spend a little while. But I can tell you there's a lot in this, saints. Now, favor is prearranged. Favor is prearranged. If you are a student of the scripture anywise, you will hear this and you will clearly understand what I just said. Favor is prearranged. Jeremiah, and I quoted it earlier today, Jeremiah 1:5, said, before I formed you in the womb, I knew and approved of you. Come on, saints. How many of you know that God approved of you before he saved you? And why is it so many today get saved and they're struggling to be approved? I'll tell you why. It's because you're not looking for God approval. You're looking for mom or dad or man or a woman approval. And because we've got all that mixed up, we never get a hold of the God approval. 95% of all the young men that come through this church have father issues. And that's why many of them that should be in ministry are disqualified, because they never, ever get that right. And their issue is so glaring, and yet they fail to look at Scripture and realize, here's Jeremiah, and God says, before I formed you, I knew you, and I approved of you. That means before he sinned. Before he did anything wrong, before Jeremiah told a real lie, God started off and said, I've already approved you. How do you know when a mother, father give birth to a child, they approve of that child before the child has a chance to grow up? And yet we have hordes of people in God's church that go around under condemnation, under self-pity, under all this false sense of identity, because they won't deal with this thing biblically. They only want to deal with it emotionally and deal with it from a level that says, I can't get right with my dad and all men are that way, or I can't get right with this one. Because of it, we go around wounded, We go around trying to overachieve, frustrating everything we do. We start things and don't finish. We don't follow through. We run from the call of God. We won't answer the call of God because we have this other issue that was settled before we got saved. I happen to be fortunate to have a good dad. I didn't say perfect. My dad drank. He was raised in the country. Eight brothers. They were a bunch of roughnecks. They all played music. They hunted bears. They did. They hunted bears, possums, raccoons, snakes, deer, ducks, geese, rabbits, squirrels. Anything walked, anything crawled, anything that was eatable, they shot it. And he grew up, and so did I. I grew up with a shotgun. I was shooting a shotgun before I could hardly get it up and hold the thing. I shot he took me duck hunting, and I shot this duck came in. I thought it was a duck coming in, and he left me. He went to another blind. It's called a little blind, the place you stand in the water and freeze to death while you wait for these ducks to come and get you or come at you. And I had this shotgun. It was a Browning 12 gauge, and I had that thing. He said, when they come in, boy, shoot them. We got to eat tonight. He laid the burden on me, you know, I'm going to feed the whole family with my shot. Well, this thing came out of nowhere, flipped down, and it was coming right at me. The only thing is, I thought I was hallucinating. It had eyes that were the size of saucers. And I thought, my God, this is like a demon. I didn't know about demons, but this is like a demon duck, you know. And this duck was coming in, and I raised up the gun, and the gun was about that far from my shoulder. It was out here. And I went, boom! But I kept going, boom, boom, boom. It pile-drived me. Boom, boom, boom. My whole shoulder was black. Pushed me into mud. Dropped the shotgun. It went in the mud. I'm through the blind. Broke the blind down. And I'm laying there. My dad's watching all this. And he comes over through the marsh. See if, I make sure I didn't kill myself. He's yelling at me, boy, get up, boy. And I'm going, I'm dead. I'm hurt. So I get up and I'm standing there, you know, and I can't even raise my arm, you know. He said, you ready to shoot some more? I don't want no gun at all. My shoulder was just crushed. And I get the gun. He looks at me. I guess he knew, and he picked up the gun and said, look what you did to my gun. Clean that thing out, boy. I couldn't raise my hand to clean it up. And he says, what'd you shoot? I said, Dad, I don't know. This was the wildest thing I ever saw. It was a duck with biggest eyes. He, what? So he took off. A few minutes later, he came back, and he had two or three things in his hand. The good news was I hit it. I shot it all to pieces because I shot enough shots to kill half the ducks in the town. But what he had in his hand was a giant old owl. I blew this owl to pieces. But you got to remember, at 10 years old, this thing dropped in on me with its kamikaze, you know, and with these eyeballs, he's coming out. I was self-defense. Boom, 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 boom. I blew every eye head out. So, of course, we went back to the lodge where we hunted, and he made sure everybody there knew. Yeah, my son got him today. He killed him a hooting owl. And they were all laughing, you know, I'm going to bed early tonight, Dad. What's wrong? You ready? We're going tomorrow. Yes, sir. I go to bed and I'm going, oh, my God. I got up in the morning when I stood in front of him here. I was bruised all over here. He finally pulled my T-shirt back, looked in there and said, okay, you can't shoot today. I said, oh, thank you, Jesus. But I want you to know something. I had a good dad. And in that process, I learned some things. I learned a lot of things about life, but I can tell you this. The church is like this story here. If you come with me today, I'm going to help some of you. There's a lot of people can't get things right. They can't get in ministry. They can't get things accepted. They're always distrusting people because something's out of whack. And how many of you know you got to come to yourself before you ever come to Jesus? You're going to get this today. You're going to get this. Now, The whole parable of Luke 15 is an answer to an accusation of the Pharisees and the scribes in verse 2. Would you go there? Verse 2. And the Pharisees and the scribes kept muttering and indignantly complaining, saying, "This man accepts and receives and welcomes preeminently wicked sinners, and he eats with them." So they're accusing Jesus of hanging out with sinners, and he even eats with them. All right? But verse 1 is really what got them. Now, the tax collectors and notorious and especially wicked. How many of you know even Luke probably had a little issue here? I mean, he didn't say they were just wicked. They were especially wicked. And sinners were all coming near to Jesus to listen to him. How many of you know something was magnetically drawing them to the Savior? And it led him to tell these three stories. There was a man with sheep. One went out, and he went and got it, and all of that. And there's a coin. When the coin is lost, we understand the story. He gets the coin back, and all those stories. But the one I'm here tonight today to talk about is the one that has to do with this son. Now, verse 25. Jesus was making a place for them at his table, and he was encouraging them to stay and eat with him. How many of you know Jesus wants every one of us to get to the fact that we're comfortable sitting with him? Some of you run in and you're like drive-by shooters. You drive by and shoot at Jesus. "How many Jesus, thank you, Lord?" Or you have that little breakfast prayer. I don't pray at dinners. I don't pray at meals at all. I stopped doing it. Why? Because when I get up and pray in the morning, I bless everything that comes near me, everything that's in my life, everything that I'm going to handle, and everything I'm going to do. I don't have to come to meal and pray. Some people, the only time they ever pray is when they get at a meal. Now, if you only have that time to pray, then go ahead. But I'm telling you, you don't need to be praying so people will see you. We need to get a hold of the fact that there's more to prayer than just praying over food. As much food as we eat today, we should be the most praying people in the world. That's a whole nother story. Now, but you got to learn that Jesus wants you to feel comfortable sitting with him, hanging out with him, spending time with him. Some of you don't spend time with him. Matthew, wake up your friend. I don't want him sleeping on me. Son, don't sleep on me. You wouldn't sleep at that movie you went to Friday night. Now, listen to me. I'm here to help you today. I'm here to help you today. You know, Satan goes about devouring whom he may. Some of you, "Oh, I can't believe you called that young man out. You fall asleep, I'll call you out." Why? Because I came this morning with a word from God for some people who need God. And I know enough about people's lives to know you need God. So come with me. If we're not comfortable sitting with Jesus, we're going to have a hard time walking with him. Now, Luke 2:25 tells us something. Now, when we hear this word used over and over, Luke uses the word in the whole of the Gospel of Luke. He's a doctor. He's a physician. He uses this word, receive, six other times. Now, it means eagerly wait, expect, or look for. And Luke uses the word receive right here in this parable of the story, okay? And I want you to get it today. I want you to see. But I'll give you the examples. Luke chapter 2, verse 25. Remember Simeon? He was in the temple, and he was eagerly waiting for the consolation of Israel, for Jesus to be brought in as a baby. Luke 2:38. Anna, the prophetess, was eagerly waiting for the redemption of Israel. How many of you know that that word waiting is not just waiting, it's eagerly waiting. I mean, it's anticipation kind of waiting. Luke 12:36, Jesus said, be like men who eagerly waiting the return of the master from the wedding feast. How many of you know there's a difference between those that are just waiting and those that are eagerly waiting? Have you ever seen a child waiting for their birthday gift or their birthday party or going somewhere? You know, they love to go. Can you ever see it? They're not waiting patiently. They're waiting eagerly. And I go, when my kids were little, I'd take them places and, man, they'd get up, you know, they'd be sleeping, they'd get up. We almost there? They'd ask, are we almost there? How far? How much further? Are we almost there? Man, I used to tell them, we have 10 more hours. And they'd get so discouraged, we'd be there in 10 minutes. And they'd go, oh, Dad! Because I'd tell them 10 hours to just shut them up. How do you know that word is important for us to get eagerly waiting? Over and over, we see the use of people eagerly waiting for. Jesus wasn't just receiving sinners. Now, get this. He was sitting in verse 2 there, chapter 15. He was eagerly waiting for them. Can you hear that? He wasn't just sitting there. And he says, and this man accepts and receives. Read it again. He accepts and receives and welcomes preeminently wicked sinners and eats with them. That word there is Jesus is looking for you to sit with him. He's not just placidly waiting, and it's like somebody in the principal's office. He's not waiting with you know, fear. He's waiting with anticipation. Can you see the difference? He wasn't just sitting there. He was expecting something to happen. He was expecting them to come. Now, here's the key. Jesus knows the beginning. Remember I told you, Jeremiah chapter 5, he knew, God knew him from the mother's womb. Hello? Jesus is expecting them to come because he knows that they're coming. The Father, I read to you in that story, got up and he could see him afar off. Do you know what that word means? It means the Father could see him before he came in sight. What that means is the Father had a sense, his seventh sense, sixth sense. His sixth sense picked it up. His son was coming home. Come on, are you listening to me? How many of you know the Father knows what your end is going to be? And he waits for you. That's why he's waiting in the prayer room for you. He's waiting at the altar for you. He's waiting for you to get up and decide you want him more than you want them. He knew he was coming back. How many of you know this boy was there for a long time? Somewhere between 4 to 6 years. The father could have given up. A normal father might have given up. But God the Father don't give up because he sees the beginning from the end. So God the Father is up waiting for you to return because he already knows you're coming back. How do you say, Lord, you knew when I was out there and all that junk beating my head against the rock. I was bumping my head against the rock thinking I had it all figured out, and you knew. God, you knew. You knew that God somehow, some way, you orchestrated people to come in my path. You put them in front of me. You set things up because you predestined, you preordered. You put your favor out in front of me before I got there. Over the next weeks, and I'm hoping for the whole month of April, we're going to make it like Friendraiser Sunday. We're going to bring people to church. You get this today, you'll get what I'm saying. And it's not, I'm not preaching this as a salvation message. I'm talking to you about a son coming back to the Father. Notice something, this boy was already saved. This boy's backslidden. He ain't coming to meet Jesus. Some preachers have preached it in salvation. It ain't salvation. It's the restoration of God. Because God knows what your end is. He already has it in motion. And he'll tolerate your rebellion and your stubbornness and all your sinful things. He'll put up with it. And he'll just keep making life tougher and tougher. Till you come to the point and say, oh my God, what will it take? I thought when the guy had a gun in my head, that was it. I thought when I was 15 foot underwater strapped in a car, that was it. I thought it was that when I was 40 feet underwater trying to swim to the surface after being almost a mile offshore on a reef at night. My surfboard got away from me and I couldn't get it, and I'm out in the surf all the way out in a riptide, and now I can't even see the land. And it's nighttime. And these boys that swim around in gray suits that have fins like that, they're around everywhere, and I'm in the water. I thought that was it. Finally. Do you know how good God is? When God is after somebody, and God is trying to bring you to the point where you're coming back to what you were intended for, because he made you for something. You see, I'm like Jeremiah. God knew I was going to be what I am. So when he called me out of the womb to be what I am. I went on my own, but he kept calling me to come back to what I am. He put so many people in my path that it became ridiculous. I mean, people were everywhere around me talking to me about Jesus, talking to me about God, and it drove me back home. That's my salvation story. But this story is about a boy that knew Jesus. And God, you know, Jesus is sitting with sinners, and he's talking to them. And he's talking to these sinners. He's hanging around with them. He uses that story to say, if God is waiting for the sinner, what more would he be doing for those that know him? Can you get this today? Over and over, we see it repeated. Jesus wasn't just receiving sinners, he was looking for them. He was expecting them to come. Now notice chapter 15, there are three parables, I've said it over and over, that are very similar. I want to pick it up. And they have several things in common. First, being lost is one thing that's in common. Being found is another thing. And all of them are followed by great joy. Can I tell you something today? Restoration and joy are synonymous. Joy and restoration are connected. When God's people don't have that natural spiritual joy of life, it's because the restoration process hasn't begun yet. You're fighting God. Some of you sitting in this room, there's a call of God in your life, and you're so fighting God. Antonio and I were talking about it the other day. You fight God so hard that when you finally surrender, and you will, the thing that you'll be only able to do would be, in your own mind, would be able to eat with the hired servants. Because you'll have wasted all that valuable time in your life pursuing a wrong pursuit. Time and purpose. You remember that message? So there's some things that are in common here, and one is being lost. How many have been lost before? Have you ever been lost in a car? Have you ever been lost anywhere? Yeah, that's a bummer, isn't it? How are you glad when you got found? Whew. How do you know there was great joy? Hello. Now, verse 6, go back to verse 6. I want you to see it. And in verse 6, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. Have you seen that? He said, rejoice with me because I found my sheep that was lost. How many of you know that God wants us to realize that the restoration of our life is joyful, and he wants to bring joy, and joy causes the restoration to speed up. When you lost a sheep that you thought you lost, you rejoice because that's money to you as a farmer. You're rejoicing. How many of you know God's people don't rejoice anymore? We stop rejoicing. America doesn't rejoice anymore. We used to rejoice over, you know, nationalistic things. Somebody would wave a flag and we'd go, wow. Somebody'd hold one up or put it on a bridge and we'd go under it. We almost wanted to salute. Now we go, oh yeah, somebody's gonna burn it. It's not funny, it's stupid. It's stupid. Because we've lost a sense of restoration which brings joy. Come on. Here's another thing, verse 9. Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that was lost. Have you heard that? And when she was found, she summons her woman friend and neighbors, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the silver coin which I lost. Wow. Now we have a sheep found and rejoicing. We have a coin found, rejoicing. Then we go down and we look at verse 23 and we have a son come home and there's rejoicing again. You can't separate these from each other. Can you hear me today? Verse 24, the son of mine was dead and has come to life again. He was lost and has been found. And they began to be merry. And look, I lost and found sheep. There was a party. Lost and found coin. There was a party. Lost and found son, there was a party. Psalm 51, verse 12. Put it on the board, please. Psalm 51, verse 12. David said, in a dark moment of his life, restore to me the joy of your salvation. Amen. Look at me today, saints. You ought to be enjoying the journey. And here's, can I help you? When you're going through a little bit of a trial, that's when you need to laugh the most. Think it no strange thing when this fiery trial comes upon you to try your faith. Come on. We need to learn that the process of God, though it may be challenging and tough at the moment, is designed to bring about the God point of view and purpose in our life. And then if you look at Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17 through 19, put it on board, I'm going to read a little bit of it. Habakkuk 3, 17, 19. How do you know that joy is like the wick to dynamite? Hello? And joy is the fuse to faith. So joy, like the wick to dynamite, faith is your dynamite, and joy is the wick. How do you know you need to blow up in faith, but you got to get the joy of the Lord going first? Because the joy of the Lord is your strength. Rejoice in the Lord. Come on. Are you hearing me today? Though the fig tree does not blossom and there is no fruit on the vines, though the product of the olive fails in the fields yield no food, though the flock is cut off from the fold and there are no cattle in the stalls. Boy, that's a dismal thing. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will exult in the victorious God of my salvation. Though I ain't got no cows, I got nothing in the field, ain't nothing working for me. Everything I put my hand to ain't working right now. I'm going to rejoice. Hello? Rejoice in the Lord again and again. Joel chapter 2, verse 22, 21 through 26. I'm going to come back to the Luke. I'm just giving you something for a minute. I'm coming right back then. We're going to finish this up. Joel chapter 2. Rejoice because God will do great things. Look at me. This fast that God wants us to do needs to have the wick lit of joy so that faith can be exploding in here. Come on. Some of you look at it like, oh my God. There'll be people that won't come to church during that week or during that 21 days because they don't want to feel like somebody might look at them because they don't want to fast. That's the truth. What games we play with our soul when we end up having to stand before God and give account and excuse for all the games we're playing. And every idle word we've spoken. Can you hear that? We need to get our attitudes adjusted to say, Lord, light the wick of my dynamite of faith so that in the right time it blows up. Can you hear me today? Joy is going to help you every step of the way. Come on. And each one of these accounts, joy came in. Watch this. The whole concept of lostness repeated in these parables is so important for us today. And I'm going to give you back an illustration that I was going to use, and I used it earlier. What I told you about the Homewood Memorial Gardens in Cook County, that somewhere between 30 and 40 people every month are buried, have no name. And lostness is a plague in our country. How do we hear that? There's never been a time when there's been so many people that nobody knows who they are. Nobody cares about them. They don't have a mother, father they can identify. They don't have a friend they can identify. Do you know how many people die all alone? The sex trade traffic that goes on in America and around the world is so overwhelming. The thousands and tens of thousands of kids, young girls, young guys that are ripped out of their homes and life and stolen, and they get stuck in some place in some foreign country and they become abused until they're no value and then they kill them. And these kids, listen, I know it from this standpoint. When I was hiding from the police and from some guys that wanted to kill me, I was sleeping on the front porch of a house of some guys I knew, and I was on the front porch sleeping on cardboard boxes, and I had taken too much drugs. And I was laying there, and I had no ID, nothing. Now, they had all left and gone. I was the only person on that front porch. If I had died, they would have come and found me, somebody would have, and they would have put me in a morgue in Puerto Rico with no identity. No one would have known. They would have put me in the ground with a tag on my toe. Because I had made it clear and had done everything. The night I left this country to go to Puerto Rico to hide, four of my best friends were arrested that night. And each of them served several years of prison because the warrant was for my name. And I was running one step ahead of the criminals and the police. And God rescued me. And had I died, I'd have been in a black bag with a tag on my toe, and no one would have known. Maybe you understand. And here it is in Chicago alone. 1 month, 68 individuals were put in a mass grave and they don't know who they were. How many of the lost cannot be laid at our feet and us have no care? Are you listening to me today? Now, as sad as that is, it's near devastation. And all that you hear, it's not, though, as devastating as being lost to God are being cut off from God? How many of you know that there are people that resist God, reject God, refuse to let God work, and their time comes up, and they're lost? Now, this misery of being lost, saints, how many of you know we have a responsibility? Verse 13. Look at it. Still with me? Please stay there. Stay with me today for a minute. Verse 13. The guy comes, and the many days after this, he gathered up all that he had and journeyed into a distant country, and he wasted his life. Running from God starts by feeling free and ends in utter misery. Either in this life or the one to come, loose living, wild, abandoned, reckless living seems free for a second, but it's like parachuting out of a plane and realizing no one loaded a parachute. Amen. How do you know the joy of jumping out? I'm going to do my own thing. Woo! And the guy in the door has got your parachute. How do you know it seems wonderful at the moment to go do your own thing? You feel like, well, this is joy, man. I'll do my own thing. You jump. And then you realize you got no parachute. Wow. Can you hear this? Verse 14. Then reality set into this young man who sent the famine. Remember, this is not a Christian. This is a Christian, not a sinner. Come on now. I'm here to tell you today, we have a lot of God's people that are just playing around, saints, and we need to understand there's a reconciliation, there's a restoration that God will bring to us that will fill our hearts with joy if we let God back in. Can you hear that today? Wow. Then reality sits in, and God sent the famine. Have you hear that? The guy's out there in verse 14, and he spent all that he had, and then a mighty famine came upon the country. How many of you know God would send a famine to get you? God would send a famine to get you. He'd stop the sun to get you. God will do a lot of things to get you. I could tell you stories of people that backslid, went away from God, lost everything, marriage, everything, got cancer, and then at the very end, they came back to Jesus. What a marvelous moment, but what a sad. You see, when God is after you, He always wins. He will get who He's after. David said, if I make my bed in hell, there you are, Lord. If I go to the deepest part of the ocean, there you are, Lord. No matter what I do, God, you're going to be there. You can run like the gazelle and not outrun God. When you get to where you think you are, He's already there waiting for you. Verse 15. He did something, and I mentioned it a minute ago. He went and glued himself, forced himself upon somebody. He attached himself to one of the citizens of the country. When you leave God, you attach yourself to other people. When you leave God and you leave the plan of God, you will always attach yourself to somebody whose ship is sinking. Because misery loves company. People will never go out and find a very successful, born again, blood washed Christian to go backslide with. They're not good company. From sonship to slavery, this boy went, verse 16. And he was longing to fill his stomach. My, my, my. We were meant to be filled with God. How many of you know that craving inside of you won't go away? You just can't. You say, I'm going home. Look, saints. We have people that have come back to church here that have been out of the church for 20 years. And they'll come back and they say, well, I went in here and I went there, you know, and I had to come home. I had a girl call me one day just before she died. She said, I know I did wrong. I know I rebelled and I know I missed God. And I said, you're right. She said, but I just wanted to get it right today. Can I do that? It's the last time I talked to her. I said, you sure can. Her and I prayed. She died. I have, you know, saints, it's great that you can go to the last minute and God still gets you and take you into heaven. Thank God for that. But why? Why would you? That hunger that you're willing to eat what the pigs eat for a non-Jew, that's got to be humbling. How do you know the hunger for God will never go away? God will put a hunger in you till you are miserable. Wow. Meant to be filled with God. Verse 17, and when he came to himself, look at it. And when he came to himself, he said, how many know sometimes we need to pray for those that we love and just say, Lord, make them come to themselves. Don't pray first that they come to Jesus. Because if they come to Jesus and they ain't come to himself, self's going to take them away from Jesus again. But if they come to self, they got to deal with self, that self's the reason they left Jesus in the first place. See, this boy dealt with himself. He got real for a minute. He got genuine. Wow. When you're alienated from God, you always are alienated from yourself. You didn't create you. You can't fix you. Only the builder, manufacturer can fix the product he made. Remember, you're made by God, like God, for God. Made by God, like God, for God. You are a genuine manufactured product. Hello. If I raise up the hood of my car, my truck out there says Ford. It ain't a Chevy, it ain't a Dodge, it ain't anything, it's a Ford. And I can't put any other product on there. It won't accept it. How many of you hear me? I had a race car, a hot car, hot rod, 66 Corvette. And there's a little piece this big, little thing. And the guy said, oh, you can put it on there. It'll be fine. And I put this little valve on there. It's supposed to open and close, supposed to do. My car ran like, terrible. You got to understand, I ran 112 octane. I ran racing fuel in this thing. That's how fast it was. And this little thing, I took it off one day. I know it's this thing because my car ran good. Remember when I was fighting that thing? Finally, I took that thing off. I turned it over because I couldn't see the bottom when it was sitting in there. Turned it over. It said Chevrolet. I took that thing. I went and got the same thing, same size, turned that sucker over, it said Ford. Put it on, boom, 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 boom. I said, now we're going somewhere. Have you know some of you are trying to put foreign parts on the God-designed product? And it ain't going to make your engine run very well. Hello. You can't add all that other stuff. You can't put all that other stuff in this thing and make it run like a God-ordered machine. Can you hear me today? Coming to yourself is a gateway of repentance and the waking up to truth. Verse 18, look what it says. Look what it says right here. I will get up. He got up a couple times. This is the second step of repentance. Knowing our sin is against God and rejecting what he made and designed us for. That's where the sin is. How do you know you got to get up? Hello? Some of you need to get up because you've been sitting with the wrong people. You got to get up and say, you know what? I can't be here anymore. How many of you remember a guy, excuse me, how many of you remember a guy named Jonah? He tried to fit in. He tried to be one of the boys. I mean, he just tried to be like one of the guys, you know, I'm going to fit in, man. Some of you have enough God on you that when you try to fit in, it's like you got a red neon light on your head. Oh, I'm just going to hang out tonight. I'm going to be there. I'm going to hang out. Some of you think you can go hang out in the clubs and in the places. And you know what happens? The demons go, hey! Because the Bible says the devil knew. Come on. So the demons see you walk in and they go, hey, right there. Target. Hello? So they got a choice. They test you to see if you got any power. If you got no power, they send you something you shouldn't have. And they usually walk up to you. And they come strutting up and you say, hey. And them demons are saying, okay, we got this one. But here's the key, kind of like, well, what's the guy's name? Job. The demon says, let's take him out. And then all of a sudden a tap comes on the shoulder. And this voice says, hey, you can buffet him, but you can't kill him. Yeah. What? We're going to deal. Okay. We got the picture. We'll leave him alone. We'll just beat on him a little ways. We'll get him so that we'll get her so she's pregnant, or we'll just get him so we'll just play with it a little bit. We won't kill him. We'll just mess it up. Because God said, look, no matter what Job did and no matter what Job does, he's mine. And because he's mine, when it's all done, I'm going to bless him. I'm going to bless him more than what he had before. He's going to end up being because I'm after him. And when I'm after him, there ain't no place he can hide. How many of you know when God's after you, you make your bed in hell, he's going to find you. Hello? Notice in verse 17 back, he came home. He came home a servant, not a son. How many hear that? When you've been a son, the way you come back is become a servant. Your way back into sonship is through servanthood. If you've been a son and you fall away, come back as a servant, you'll be restored. See, some go away and want to come back and they want to be sons. They're not sons. Sonship has been lost. They're servants. And the servanthood heart brings them back into full restoration of sonship. Now notice verse 20. I'm about ready to land. The son got up. He got up a couple times. He was still wrestling. Some of y'all need to get up and run. The son got up and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, the father saw him. Have you said, Lord? You see, when I went to church the first time, the father saw me coming. How many of you know that there are some out there today that God sees them coming? And when they come, I hear this all the time, people that fall away, afraid to come back to the church. you got to read this story. The Father sees you coming. And when you start coming, he knows your heart. He starts preparing all the blessing that was yours in the first place to be restored back to you. So when you come home, God restores you. Look at it. Wow. The Father saw what was prearranged from the womb. He saw afar off. He sees the beginning from the end. He ran to his son. How many of you know that right there alone messes my head up? He ran. Can you imagine this, saints? Get a picture. You come to the altar. You come in repentance because you walked away from the call of God. Prophets will speak to you and you don't even pay any attention to it. Yeah, that was just a prophet. That was just a crazy prophet. If you're not a prophet, you have no business judging the prophet. You better pay attention. When a prophet comes and prophesies to you, you can't throw that into the trash can. Because it was what was created to be part of your life when you were made in the womb, and he's held it up till this time. But can you imagine coming in and having, Charlie, I'm going to come in. Would you just run at me? You're the only one in here probably can still run. I'm coming to Jesus. And there, look how quick he came. Can you imagine the Father coming to us when he sees us coming? He ran to say, oh my God, I've wanted you. Oh my God, you've just been my son all this time. I've got everything already set in motion. They're in the kitchen. They're cooking the calf for you. I had the new bathrobe all ironed out, or the robe ironed out. I got sandals just made for you, son. I got a ring. Let me get it off my hand. I had it on my hand all this time because, son, I got to be honest with you. I knew you were coming home. I knew you were coming just like I knew the ram was coming up the other side of the hill. When my son obeyed the word of the Lord and brought Isaac to me, I knew the ram was coming. When you make a move back to God, God says, I'm coming. I'm running. We used to sing a song in the revival. I'm running. I'm running. God in the mercy seat is running back to you because he sees you coming back. But let me tell you something. Until that boy came to himself, he could have come to the altar, and this happens all the time. Come to himself? Nope. They come to the altar and they want mercy and pity, but they ain't ready. They still like eating what the pigs eat. But when you had enough, there's joy. There's some people, they just think they can just keep playing that game. And you know what happens? Good God, I've been around. They come home and they're dragging. They're like these veterans of ours that come home. They ain't got an arm anymore. They left a leg. They got brain damage. God is merciful. He'll take you right to heaven. You can come in and he'll usher you back in. Broken, limbs missing, but he'll take you back in. But the sad thing is, you could have served him with everything. But you kept offering pieces of yourself to the pig farmer. My. Stand your feet, will you? Look at verse 20 while you're standing. Put it on the board, verse 20. Remember, he got up. The whole verse 20 through 23, this is unrestrained restoration. God restores because it is his purpose that you were meant to fulfill. I'm going to end it with a statement by Martin Luther, the great Reformationist. We're getting ready to celebrate 500 years of Reformation. Listen to what he said. Martin Luther, the great revival, the great Reformationist, he said, "If I could believe that God was not angry with me, I would stand on my head for joy." Do you know, saints, what is it that these boys, these young men want? And the girls too. They want their father's approval. Isn't that right? They want a father's approval. Here's a great revivalist, and he says, "If I just knew God wasn't mad at me, I'd stand on my head for joy." Can I tell you, just read Jeremiah chapter 5. When you were in the womb, he knew you. He called you. And he totally forgave you while you were in the womb. You hadn't even done anything. And he settled it all before you came. Do you know when you came to that altar? You had to repent. But he already knew the beginning from the end. So when you were repenting, he saw you repented because he knew you were going to come back. He's always been there. You know, there's a story. I got so many stories. A young man had a prayer life going on. He was in London. Man spent every day with God, every day. Then he got busy. And he stopped praying every day. He just stopped praying every day. A little bit, not much. Just a little bit, not much. And one morning he got up and he was walking down the hallway of his house. He was in a hurry, had his stuff, and he was going out the door. And as he walked by this room, the door was open and the fireplace was on. There was fire in the fireplace. And he stopped. He got to the door and he stopped and he came back slowly. He said, "I know that there was no fire in there last night." And he said he got real close to the door and he got overwhelmed with fear, but it was God fear. And he put his hand on the door and he just looked in, real apprehensive. Didn't know if it was a burglar, but he knew really down inside who it was. When he pushed the door, there was a figure sitting on the couch with his back towards him, looking at the fireplace. And a voice came out of this figure and said, "Oh, I'm so glad you stopped. I've been waiting here every day for you." And that man dropped to his knees right at the doorway and wept and cried for God to forgive him. He bawled like a baby and God restored him. Close your eyes a minute. Maybe he walked by and he kept going. Or maybe you're like that guy and you say, "Lord, I can't walk by you anymore. I need to come back into this thing. I need to come back with my whole heart. I need to give it all that I have. I need to be 100%er. I need to be all that I'm supposed to be. And I'm so desperate to come back into your presence, God, that, Lord, it doesn't matter if I serve with the servants, I'm willing to do that. But I know that I know it's time to come home. Father, I pray over this house that there are sons and daughters, there are those young men and young women, older and in between, that are called by you, God. And may their world become misery to them. That's my prayer. May their world become miserable right now in the name of Jesus. Wherever they're at, may their world become a place of misery. That they would stop for a moment and say, oh my. May they rise up and say, I gotta go home. I gotta go back. I glued myself to other people. I connected myself to others. But I'm hungry, and what they're feeding me, I can't be satisfied. I can only be satisfied if I get back and eat what my Father's serving. What my Father's serving is what will supply every need I have. So today, Holy Spirit, like a searchlight from heaven, shine down over the hearts of your people and search us, O God. Search our hearts, O God. And may the searchlight of heaven extend beyond the borders of this room. May it begin to search from place to place, location to location, one side to the next side of the street, God. May the searchlight of heaven be shined out from glory tonight, God, and tomorrow and the next day, till there is a hunger, till there is a desire that men and women that are supposed to be serving the living God would run back and answer the call of God. And not be consumed with the corporate America's deception. With the desires of the culture. May the culture loose them today. Loose them today, God. Loose them today from the culture that holds them prisoner. We pray for our loved ones, our friends, our neighbors, our co-workers, those that have been in the house, those that have been part of the house, those that have been part of the purpose and plan that you have. God, unfeather their nest. Make them like the little eagle. Make them uncomfortable in the nest of the world. And may this prayer that comes out of this house today, may it echo, may it fuel the fire of heaven. And may the church begin to pray. Begin to pray. Begin to pray. Until there's a cry that says, I must. I must face myself. I must face myself today. I can't blame anybody, but I must face myself today. I miss eating at my Father's table. I miss being at my Father's house. I miss all that my Father has. Church of the living God, can you pray today? This is an intercession message today. It is a message that God would impregnate into us, that we would just stop playing church and begin to really get desperate enough to say, oh God, oh God, you see them, oh God. You see them in the pig pen of of life. Miserable. Oh God, put hunger in them. Hunger for the Father. Hunger for the Father's word. May they become so hungry, God, that they are absolutely miserable. And then even those in the house today, Father, I pray for them. I pray for those here right now. You see, I didn't preach this because I saved it for right now. But when that boy got up and left and wanted everything, he's like a lot of the Christian kids and young people. He'd been around Father's house, had everything. Had everything. And yet, the lure of Satan, the lust of Lucifer, so tricked him that he rose up and said, I think it's probably more fun doing something else. I think I could have fun somewhere else. I think if I could just get some of my money, I could really go out there and really have a blast. There ain't nothing new under the sun. Satan has been a liar since the beginning. He still is a liar. He's the father of lies. He's never told the truth, don't know how to tell the truth. He's a liar of lies. And he tricked those of us. He tricked those before. He tricked hundreds of years ago. He's a master con artist. And I've come today to uncover his sick plan. And by prayer, I expose that demonic force that works to rob a generation and cause that generation to be so casual that the lust of the pig farm is only a block away. Father, in Jesus' name, let conviction work in this house. Burden us, O God, as we enter into this fast. We begin to pray even now, God. And it's one of the things that we'll pray for, saints of God. We're going to pray like we've never prayed before. We're going to get serious in this house. We're going to get serious about praying for those that are playing the game and are about ready to be set up by Lucifer. We're going to block that thing. We're going to block that thing before it happens. We're going to block that thing in the power in the name of Jesus. We're going to block that spirit from being able to take and seduce and draw those future generational young men and young women out of the house of God. And young men and young women that are called of God are going to answer the call. And God, we're going to believe that you're going to bring increase in every arena, God. You're going to bring the backslider in. You're going to bring those of yesterday. You're going to bring those before and those back and those in the past. You're going to shake the tree of this house. And God, this tree is a fig tree that does produce fig. It does produce fruit in its season, oh God. Carabocurite. Yay, Labo Roche, Labahate. We intercede today. We pray the prayer of the righteous. That husbands come home, that wives turn around, children come back, children turn before it's too late. Let fire come in the nursery and the children's church. Let anointing come. And what we do, may we do it by prayer. What we do, may we do it by prayer. For the prayer of the righteous availeth much. The prayer of the righteous availeth much. Don't despise me, saith the Lord. Don't despise what I'm doing in this house, saith the Lord. Don't despise what I'm doing, for I am going to sift, and I am going to shake, saith the Lord, and I am going to rattle your cages, saith the Lord. And when it is done, you will stand on holy ground. You will stand in the anointing. And you will stand in the plan. For as you turn to me, I've already begun to run towards you, saith the Lord. If you turn to me, saith the Lord, when I see your face, I will run towards it. And nothing can stop me. When I begin to run towards you, saith the Lord, I will run over every demonic force, every hindering force, and I will apprehend you. I will apprehend so that you might apprehend what you have been apprehended for. For this day, the spirit of slumber that left a mark over this house today has been lifted in Jesus' name. There is an anointing in the house now because the word of the Lord is true. It is a true word from heaven. It will make the comfortable uncomfortable. It will make the weary strong. Some of you, the world has captured your mind. The world has captured your thoughts. And the kingdom of God is no longer one. It's not even two on your list. You have to fit God in on your daytimer. It is a trick of Lucifer. It is a trick of the enemy. If God cannot supply your needs, He's not God. You give your heart, your life, your tithe, your everything over to Him, and He'll supply all of your needs according to His riches. And when you die, it will be said, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." For the enemy has come to open doors. God said, "I open doors that no man can open, and I close doors that no man could open. And I open doors that only I can open," saith the Lord. If you make me God, you make me everything. I've come to show you that I am God. Your hands will become the hands of the miraculous. Your hands will become the hands of the supernatural. You will put your hands out, and the power of God will rest on your hands. You will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover. You will see miracles happen through your own hands. You will touch your checkbook. You will touch your stocks. You will touch your bonds. And they will turn around. Revelation and understanding will come from every direction. For I have searched the earth to find a people that will be my people, saith the Lord. And I have chosen to put my name over this house. I have chosen to write my name over this house. It will be with you, or it shall be with another, but it will be, saith the Lord. It will be with you or with another, saith the Lord, but it will be. For I take not back my word, saith God. I have spoken my word many, many times in this house. And some of you have treated it like it was mere men. This day I hold you accountable to the word that I have spoken over this house. I hold you responsible, saith the Lord. That which I have spoken will come to pass. As I said to Israel, they could have entered the promised land, but as unbelief came in their hearts, and because they mixed it not with faith, they never received what God said that was theirs. But God's saying today that I'll give it to another if you refuse to receive it, saith the Lord. I'll give it to another, but it will happen on this place, because this place is where I chose to put my name, saith God. If you will put yourself in front of me, the days and the weeks ahead, can I find you? I'll wait, saith the Lord. I'll sit in the prayer room. I'll sit in the sanctuary of this house, in my holy presence. For God says out of Isaiah, he sent the angel of his presence. And God's saying today, he's going to send the angel of his presence to sit in the prayer room and sit in this house. And when you come in here, you will feel the anointing before you crack the door. As you open the door to come in, you will feel waves and waves and waves of the glory of my presence, saith the Lord. When you open the door, you will feel like something has already started to happen. When you walk in the prayer room, you will feel something that grips you and begins to hold on to you, and you will feel the anointing. Anointing of God in a way that you have not sensed, and you will not let go of the altar. You will not let go of the horns of the altar until there's a breakthrough. And when there's a breakthrough, rejoicing will come. Get ready to laugh. Get ready to dance. Get ready to shout. God is I feel like God's about to take the breath out of me. I just feel like the breath of God is just coming out of me. I can't hardly contain. I want to say this to you, and I want you to listen. Please open your eyes and look at me a minute. I don't do these things by impulse. For the last 3 days, some of you that have been in those revival meetings, I used to tell you something that would happen to me when I came to this platform and I would stand here. Who remembers? What did I say? Yeah. Rosemary, you got it. For the last 3 days, I felt like I lost my mind. I turned around and answered 3 different times. That's all I can do is stand here right now. But 3 different times, the hand of God so on my shoulder. I turned, I thought my wife wanted me. I turned, I thought I was bumping something. And then I turned and said, Lord, where are you at? I can only tell you this. Something wonderful is about to happen. Now, it can happen with you. It won't have to happen with you. When God showed up in 1997, there were people that actually left the church because too much of God came in. Now, there were people that came from everywhere, all over the world. But there were people that said, you know, it's too much of God. If you'll pray with me here at the end, I'm going to pray this prayer, that you'll handle the overwhelming power and presence of God. But you won't let it, by your flesh, push you, but draw you. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, I thank you for the anointing. Holy Spirit, come in this place. Turn it upside down, inside out. Do miracles, supernatural inventions. Interventions. If you're here today and you say with me, well, I got to get right with God. Right where you're standing, just slip your hand up real quick. I'll pray for you. Put it up. Yes, yes. Put it up. Quickly. Don't play any games here. You held your hand up. I want you to come and stand right here to my right, quick, right now, just quick. Get out of your seat, come right now. If you held your hand up, come now. If you didn't, forget it, because you won't walk with God, you won't even try, because you can't walk 10 feet. Come right here, right to the right, my right. Now, a couple of you guys get here with them. Just get around them and pray with them, isolate them. Now here's prayer. That's enough, we don't need everybody. That's enough, John, thank you. I'm going to pray for you. I mean, you're still here. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray right now. What a moment. We are standing at a threshold of supernatural interventions of God. Lord, I pray that outside of this arena, the homes of those that call this their church, you will disrupt, you will interfere, and you will cause revelation to come. You will cause people to say, oh my God, I hear something, I've got to get up. In the next days and the next weeks, may this prayer room be lit up with desperate people that say, I must eat what the Father is serving. Father, in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray that you will so move on the hearts of your people. They will not just walk out of here and go, another church service. Thank you, Jesus. But we'll grip this moment and say, thank you, Lord. I was there when the earth cracked and the openings began to happen. Water is going to come out of the ground, and water shall come out of the heavens. And this place shall be washed in every area of every ministry. Father, I pray this. I pray that you will stir the hearts of your people. And I want to do something here. Young men are coming to the Lord. It's what God wants to do. We're going to see these altar calls are going to be prophetic signs. You hear me? Their altar calls are going to be prophetic signs. There'll be marriages, couples that will come, and God's going to start doing things in marriages. Young men will start coming because God's going to do things with young men. Young ladies will come. God's going to do. Kids will come. God's going to do. God's going to make the altar a prophetic signpost of what we're going to see happen in this next. People are going to come sick and go away healed. It's the signpost of God. This altar is a signpost of what God wants to do. And lastly, I want you to do this. I want you to do something financial today. Hear me out. Now, if the enemy lied to you when I just said that just then, you can either do this, one thing or the other. You can tell him to shut up, or you can not give. But I want you to give today, those of you that hear God, because what we're going to see is those three things. The lost coins coming back, the sheep coming back, the sons coming back. And listen, even the older brother who I left alone, oh yeah, God's going to deal with the older brother. Some of you are going to have to make room. I want you to do this. I want you to bring an offering. I want you to bring it because you heard God. I said it about Thursday night. Stop right now. Pray with me. I need you to bring an offering. I need you to sow. We're going to see breakthrough happen. Come on. We're going to see some breakthroughs happen. How many of you are listening? Did that moment of talking about an offering, if that moment took you out of God, you didn't get in God. So you didn't get out of God. You just weren't in God. Because money is never something that should turn us away. It should turn us towards. Because where your treasure is, I said it Thursday night, I can look at your checkbook and I can look at your day timer. And I can find out if God's number one or number five or number 10. Let's pray together right now. So don't do nothing. Some of you start doing things and you don't even pray. I'm asking you to pray. Come on, saints. Get up on your feet. Everybody, please, if you can, stand up. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, speak to your people, Lord. Let me testify. Stop. Just stop. Listen to me. A woman came recently and said God told her to come to the prayer room. And as she came to the prayer room, God said, if you'll go to the prayer room there and if you'll do what I tell you, I want you to give. She doesn't attend this church, but she comes to the prayer room and she gives. So God told her to give $10,000 for the building, for the house downtown, because she was in the prayer room. She didn't go to this. She goes to another church. Because God's trying to help us. But listen, this person already commented. What a shame the people of this church don't hear what's going on in the prayer room to release faith over this house. I mean, what do you do with somebody? They ain't doing anything but praying and going to and giving money. You can't deal with them very. If they were in the church, maybe I could correct her. But you know, God will do things beyond our ability to comprehend? How do you think God could do something? Just pray, Father, in this atmosphere, this prophetic word today of intercession, Holy Spirit, speak to your people right now. Right now. Right there. Right where they stand. Give them that exact amount so that they can obey you and see the return. Holy Spirit, thank you. Whew. Wow. Amen. Whatever you sing, it's going to be worship and just easy. Just do something easy. Saints, don't miss church. Don't miss church in the next few weeks here. Something is up. Bring your gift. Bring your love. Sing something that worships Him.